So we've demonstrated the idea that graphically what we're trying to do is start with a secant line and then bring those two points closer and closer together so the distance between them is virtually nothing. So let's start with the slope of a line or the slope of our secant line. Connecting two points on our graph. So let's say we have one point at x equals a and a second point at x equals a plus h, meaning the distance between these two points is h. Excuse me. So we'll have our first point at x equals a second point at x equals a plus h, meaning that our function values here will be our function evaluated at a and our function evaluated at a plus h. So we could again start off with our definition for the slope of our secant line, which is y2 minus y1 over x2 minus x1. Rewriting this function with some of the notation that we have over here now, our value for x2 is a plus h, and our value for x1 is going to be a. Then in the numerator, our coordinate for y2 will be f of a plus h minus f of a. So what we can see in the denominator is that our values for a are going to cancel out, which leaves us with f of a plus h minus f of a all over h. So at this point, you may or may not recognize the expression that we've got here, but this is the difference quotient. Which we already talked about once before when we were introducing our concepts for limits. So we have this updated expression for the slope of our secant line. To get the rate of change specifically at this point A, we again want to think about taking this point A plus H and bringing it closer and closer, so decreasing that distance between them, meaning this value for H needs to continue getting smaller and smaller. So to get that rate of change at a point, what we're going to do is consider what's happening as h approaches 0. So we'll take the limit of that difference quotient as h approaches 0. And that will give us the slope of the tangent line at exactly this point, x equals a, which means this expression will give us the rate of change of our function at x equals a. So we can generalize that a little bit. For any value of x, instead of some specific value a, so the derivative of f at some value x, or at any value of x, which we can also notate as f prime of x, so that f prime notation is just a shorthand way of saying the derivative of f at x. Or another way that this can be notated is to say df over dx. So there's some different notations for indicating the derivative that we'll use throughout the semester. So to find the derivative, we take the limit as h approaches 0 of f of x plus h minus f of x divided by h, assuming that this limit exists. So if that result doesn't exist, if it leads us to a result of does not exist, infinity, negative infinity, anything like that, then we'd have to say that the derivative at x doesn't exist. So it's important to understand that we do have these cases where the derivative may not exist. So what we want to look at is how we could recognize those types of occurrences graphically. So the derivative wouldn't exist if our function is discontinuous at some specific point x equals a. So we've got a couple of different ways that could happen. We could have a hole or a break in the graph, or we could have a vertical asymptote. So if our function has a point of discontinuity, the derivative is going to be undefined at that point. Everywhere else in the domain for the function, it will be differentiable, but at these specific points, these values for x, our function would not be differentiable. Another place where it would not be differentiable is if our function has a sharp corner. At x equals a. So if we had a graph that came to a sharp corner at any point, essentially what's happening at this specific instant at x equals 0, our function would sort of be simultaneously decreasing and increasing. So if the derivative is telling us about the rate of change, well, the rate of change can't be both positive and negative at the same time. So in that case, we would say that the derivative does not exist. This would be anytime we have a function of the form y equals absolute value of x. So anytime we have an absolute value function, somewhere there's going to be that sharp corner. And the last case would be if our function has a vertical tangent line. At x equals a. So this would be uncommon for probably anything in this course, but if we had a function that sort of dipped down to a point and then immediately started curving back up in a manner like that. So at this point, the tangent line would be completely vertical, and a vertical line has an undefined slope, so our derivative would be undefined. So we have a definition for the derivative established, which is taking the limit of something very similar to that difference quotient. But we also want to keep in mind there are going to be cases where the derivative would be undefined or would not exist.